Hello everyone, so this is question number 23, the first numerical of gate 2018. So what is the meaning of PN wave? So PN waves are such kind of seismic waves. Let us say, suppose this is the surface of the earth and this is some layer inside, okay? And suppose an earthquake is generated at this point. So PN wave means those seismic wave which will come to the surface but after some amount of refraction in some other layers. That means it will go somewhere below. It will refract in another layer and then it will come to the surface. So this kind of waves are called PN waves, right? And we have to find out the minimum distance from the epicenter. Now see, the earthquake is called near surface earthquake. That means this distance from the surface, it is very small. So we can also take that, we can neglect this distance and we can take that this is the surface. Okay, we can neglect it because it will be very small. Okay, very small compared to this height or this depth. Okay, so let us neglect that and take it to be to the, on the surface itself. Now what will be the epicenter? Epicenter will be this distance, right? That will be the epicenter distance. Now we ask that the what is the minimum distance from the epicenter of an earthquake at which the PN waves are observed. We know that PN waves, okay, they are the those waves which arrive to the surface after some refraction. So what can be the minimum amount of refraction? So if we decrease this distance we need to decrease to get the minimum distance at which it will arrive on the surface. So when we decrease this distance, we can at max decrease it to here, right? So that means we can say that okay, our ray went down and it got refracted for a small distance and then it came up, right? So the minimum distance will be now this one at which the PN waves can be observed, okay? So that is the minimum distance because this is the minimum amount of refraction that can happen for that wave, okay? That means we have to find out this distance. Okay, so that distance in our diagram, it is that MN distance. Okay, so everything is given, that is the crustal depth given because the earthquake is near surface, right? So if it is near surface means what? It is near the, it is somewhere in the crust. Okay, so let us say this location is the earthquake location and we have ignored this small height and we have taken that, okay, this location is at the surface. We have ignored the small amount of distance between the surface and the earthquake location, okay? So that location is at the surface we have taken, right? And then also given that P wave velocities are given in the upper crustal and upper mantle. That means this V1 and V2 are the velocities of that P wave in that crust and mantle, okay? So that is given to us, right? So now we need to find out that MN distance. Also that H height is given, height or depth, that is given as 35 kilometer because there is a crust, right? So let us take this angle of incidence to be theta c, then we can find out by trigonometry that this distance will be h 10 theta c, and we need to find out mn will be twice h 10 theta c, right? So twice h 10 theta c, so we need to find out a theta c. Now we know that using Snell's law, sin theta c will be equal to mu 2 by mu 1 or v1 by v2. V1 by v2 means the velocities which are already given to us, right? Velocity in the upper layer and lower layer. So that way we can get theta c as 52.18. So thus we can put this theta c in that 10 theta value and we will get the MN distance, that is 90.17. So 90.17 is the required answer, okay? So this epicentral distance, minimum distance to get the PNF, okay? So let us go to the next question now, question number 24. So the next question is about velocity of P wave using the Wiley time average equation. So this is just a direct formula based, okay? You can see there is this equation called Wiley time average equation, okay? So that will give us the velocity of P wave in a sandstone or any rock, okay, having some porosity, okay? So we are given that we have a sandstone where we have matrix and oil, okay? So the velocity of P wave in that sandstone matrix is given as 5600 meter per second and in oil it is given as 1200 meter per second, right? So we just need to find out the velocity using that equation. So that equation is directly giving us that 1 by V, that is the required velocity, equal to porosity by VL. VL means velocity in oil or liquid, okay? And 1 minus phi means whatever is the porosity here, 1 minus that porosity divided by VM. VM means velocity in matrix. So everything is given, porosity is 30%, so it will be 0.30, 1 minus 0.30 will be 0.70, and we can solve it to get the answer as 2666 meter per second, okay? The answer is actually meter per second. Okay, so this is directly formula based. So let us go to the next question now. So the next question is about porosity. So it is given that the total porosity is 20% and we asked about the void ratio, right? So we know that porosity, so I have written it P, porosity P equal to 20%. So we know porosity means volume of voice by volume total. So if it is in percent test, that means volume total is 100%. So that indirectly means that volume of voice is 20%, right? Okay. So that is indirectly given. That means, so volume of voice is 20%. Then what will be the volume of the solid particles? It will be 80%, right? Because remaining will be solid particles. If void is 20%, remaining will be solid particles. So it will be 80%, right? Solids. And what is void ratio? Void ratio, we have the formula: volume of voice by volume of solids. That means 20/80. Okay, if you put percentage, then also it will be the same. So finally, it will be 1/4, and in percentage it is asked, so it will be 25%. Okay. So let us go to question number 45 now. So the next numerical is question number 45. So in this numerical, you can see it is given that 50 kg of an explosive, okay, and with a yield of, that means 5 megajoule per kg. That means every kg of that explosive, it gives out 5 megajoule of energy, right? So this mass will be required to break how much? 100 meter cube of the marble. That means total is 50 kg of explosive, and per explosive your energy is 5 megajoule per kg, right? So that is, so if we multiply 50 into 5, that will be the total energy released, right? And this mass will be able to break how much? 100 meter cube of our that marble. So the question is that how much will be, or how much explosive will be required to break 1 meter cube of this, right? Breaking a unit, that means 1 meter cube of that marble. So that means it is simply unitary method. Unitary method means what? For 100 we are given how much is required, 50 into 5. So for 1 meter cube how much will be required, that is we need to find out. So but just bring the 100 this side, right? So it will be equal to same 50 kg into 5. Now this is megajoule, right? So mega means 10^6, right? Now what is joule? Joule is newton into meter, right? Force into distance by kg, and that 100 also will come this side. So that 100 let us write here, okay? So that means now it will be equal to, so we can cancel all the things. So once we cancel, so we will finally get, okay? So finally, if we do the calculation, so this will be 2.5, because this 0 and this 0 will go, 25 by 10 will be 2.5, and 10^6 will be 10, and this kg and the upper kg will go, right? So we have cancelled the kg and kg, right? And on the other side we had meter cube, and this side we had meter. So this meter and the meter cube, so this side will remain meter square, okay? So it will be 2.5. now 10^6 is mega, so we have written m, okay? And this meter square we have bought this side, so it is mega newton per meter square, right? So that, because we have brought this side, because this is the unit that is needed, mega newton per meter square. So it will be 2.5 mega newton per meter square for 1 unit volume to break, okay? Because we are asked about 1 unit, okay? So that is why 2.5 will be the answer. All right, so let us see the next numerical now.